Now, let us see what was happening in the southern part of India, especially Mysore. The company started facing threat both politically and economically from Mysore. Mysore had grown into a strong state under King Hyder Ali. Tipu Sultan, son of King Hyder Ali, was a very strong ruler in southern Indian state of Mysore. He was known as Tiger of Mysore, as there was an interesting story in this regard. It goes on like this. That once Tipu fought with a tiger unarmed and killed the tiger, due to which he got this title. In 1785, Tipu controlled the trade of Malabar coast and stopped the export of pepper, sandalwood and cardamom from his ports. He also stopped local merchants to deal with Britishers. To modernize his army, he employed French to his army. Britishers became furious and tried to suppress the power of Mysore. For this, four wars were fought between Britishers and Mysore, all are known as Anglo-Mysore War. Tipu was killed in the war of 1799 at Seringapatam. After that, Wadayars became king of Mysore with the condition of subsidiary alliance. But the problem didn't end here. After the problem of Mysore was sorted off, a new problem arose, the Marathas. In the late 18th century, the company started facing problems from the Marathas who were aiming to rule over India through Delhi and which was taken as the seat of power in India. Marathas were divided into many states under different chiefs belonging to dynasties such as Sindhias, Holkers and Gaikwads. They had three wars with Britishers known as Anglo-Maratha Wars. The third Anglo-Maratha War totally crushed the Maratha power and Britishers got complete control over territories south of the Vindhyas. So we can say that the company had pursued aggressively in territorial expansion and now they wanted something more, and that was supremacy on whole India. Now let us see how Britishers initiated themselves as supreme power. East India Company, under the leadership of Lord Hastings, initiated a policy of paramountcy, means supreme power. Here please make it clear that Lord Hastings and Warren Hastings were two different persons, so don't get confused. So, in order to become a paramount power, they started annexation of different territories of India. During this process of annexation, they also faced some resistance at some places. Like Rani Chinnamma, the Queen of Kittur, led an anti-British resistance movement, though she was finally arrested in 1824. In late 1830s, the company became worried about Russia, who it thought could give a tough competition to the company. For this, it tried to secure the northwest frontier of India by fighting a prolonged war with Afghanistan between 1838-1842 and established an indirect rule there. It also took over Sindh in 1843. Even Punjab, which Britishers were not able to annex during the reign of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, was finally won over by Britishers in 1849. Now we know that most of the India was under control of Britishers because of their vigorous policy of annexation. They also used political methods of annexation. So next in line was the policy of doctrine of lapse. Do you have any idea about this concept? Let me tell you. This type of annexation took place under the governorship of Lord Dalhousie. Under this doctrine, any Indian king who doesn't had a natural male heir had to give away his territory to the Britishers. With this policy, the company took control over Satara, Sambalpur, Udaipur and Jhansi. Jhansi, as you all know, is famous for its brave Queen Rani Lakshmi Bai. She was the widow of Raja Gangadhar Rao. Jhansi was also annexed by the Britishers. Such incidents led to the revolt of 1857. as the company had gained control over almost whole of the India and had become master of the Indian land, so now there arises the need of administering of the acquired territories. That means after acquiring so many territories, now Britishers were concerned about how to administer them. So now let us see how Britishers set up their new administration. Hastings divided administration into three presidencies, namely Bombay, Madras, and Bengal. He also codified laws with the help of Hindu pandits and Muslim muftis in order to do justice as per the prevailing laws in India. He also established courts such as criminal court and civil court. They are also known as Fauzdari and Diwani respectively. And also appointed collectors to collect revenue and maintain law and order. The Britishers were done with both annexation and administration of the Indian territories. Now they felt the need of an army. So now let us see the structure of the company's army. The new British administration brought some new ideas of administration. But like any other administration, the power of Britishers was also dependent on a strong army. So they started recruiting Indian peasants and workers to their own army. Just like the Mughal army that composed of Savars, soldiers on horseback, and paddle, foot soldiers. British army also had cavalry consisting of both Savars and paddles who were trained in archery and sword fighting. But with the passage of time, new warfare techniques were introduced, such as muskets, means heavy guns, and matchlocks, guns ignited by a match. There arose a need of developing new techniques among Indian soldiers with uniformity and discipline, which sometimes was against the community feelings of the Indian sepoys. This created a discontent among Indian soldiers, which in 1857 became one of the reasons of revolt against Britishers, which we will read in next chapter. Thus, after going through the content of this chapter, we come to a conclusion that it is right to say that a company known as East India Company that entered India in order to trade finally gained power over the territories of India and became a ruler of our country.